Welcome to The Digital Patient, where we discuss the latest advancements in digital patient engagement and share stories from the front lines. I'm your host, Alan Sardana, and with me as always is Seamless MD CEO, Dr. Joshua Liu. Today, we're joined by our very special guest, Ben Chao. Ben is the president of CareConnect at MultiCare Health System. He's responsible for extending the EHRs and other technology solutions to strategic partners. Ben also holds a dual role as principal of MultiCare Capital Partners, the system's strategic and social impact investment arm. Ben has held several positions of progressing accountability at MultiCare, starting as an administrative fellow. He most recently served as director of technology advisory services, facilitating the organization's digital transformation to deliver consumer-obsessed, provider-empowering, high-value care. Ben has brokered mergers and acquisitions, led market strategy and facility planning, and ran MultiCare's virtual urgent care and telehealth provider service teams. Ben has a Bachelor of Arts from the University of California at Berkeley and a Master's in Health Administration from the University of Washington. He is the treasurer of Seattle Adaptive Sports, where he coached their youth wheelchair basketball team for 6 years, and a regular guest instructor at the University of Washington. Ben, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Alan. Thanks, Josh. Great to be with you guys this morning.
It's amazing to have you on the show, Ben. You've carved out the most fascinating career for yourself. You, like the bio suggested, you've led digital transformation for a multi-hospital health system. You've also implemented virtual care and digital care journeys for patients, and you're actively discovering and supporting the growth of healthcare innovation across many different avenues with MultiCare's innovation arm, the Capital Partners. So coming from the administration world, I'm curious to start the conversation, you know, how did you first get involved in digital health?
Yeah, you know, like a lot of mentors and people in the industry, I think that a lot of folks start out in some type of operational role or maybe in a financial role or a strategic planning role, and they kind of fall into it. You know, for me, I'd always been really fascinated by the appeal of what virtual care could bring. And so when I joined MultiCare 5 years ago as an administrative fellow, that was at the top of my list of things to think about, just from an access perspective, from a potential return on investment perspective, et cetera. And at the time, there were a number of industry barriers that really made adoption of virtual care difficult, whether it was payer regulations or payer parity or access to broadband or everyone having the right devices and two dozen different video clients. And so there was actually a moment in time in my career where I kind of was turned off by the options because I thought there were too many barriers. But in the back of my mind, I always had that picture of, I think it was a scene from The Jetsons where Elroy gets looked at by a doctor through a screen. And I was like, oh my gosh, they predicted this back in the 70s or 80s or whenever this was put together. So I figured, you know, it's only a matter of time. And, you know, a lot of it, I think, came down to luck. At the time when I had a boss of mine, Christine McCarron, who recently retired at MultiCare. She was our senior vice president of retail health and community-based care. She led everything that really wasn't a hospital or in the medical group at the time, right? She had at some points quality, strategy, some of our specialty service lines. By the time she retired, it was lab imaging, pharmacy, retail health, post-acute care, which was just an incredible amount of responsibility. And she was the person who, every time we had a new project that required creativity, she would get the call from our CEO and COO and say, we need you to run with this. And so she took a flyer on me when my predecessor left, and she said, I know you don't know everything, and I don't want you to be too concerned about not knowing enough, because the team that you're going to be running with just knows different things. They don't know more than you, which, you know, for someone who's a couple years out of grad school is the most affirming, you know, words of encouragement you could ever hear. And she said, I know you're going to throw yourself into it though. And that's what matters. And so fast forward a couple of years, and I've gotten to work with some really great internal and external strategic partners. And I think that what I've been really blessed with is just opportunities to take an open lane. Good example, when COVID hit us in March of 2020, we were finally able to do something that we had never been able to, because it was understandably risky from a financial and compliance perspective. And it was give out virtual care for free to the community as a public health service and benefit for folks who were concerned about whether or not they had COVID or the flu or just a standard cough or whatever it might be. And we were able to really blow the doors off of what folks thought was possible from a virtual urgent care perspective. And so ever since then, we've been working to continue to scale that success and really have it stick as we go into year two of the pandemic.
Oh, that's really awesome. I actually did not know that MultiCare did that. That's really awesome. I think a common thread that I found throughout all of your career thus far, Ben, and I know it's an exciting path ahead of you as well, but is your emphasis on using data to accomplish specific goals. So whether it's improving the consumer experience, like you mentioned, or even solving health equity, data has been kind of at the forefront behind all your decisions. And so I'm curious, what are the most exciting ways today that MultiCare is using data to deliver care?
So I think that back when I was running our virtual care team and our telehealth teams, you know, it was kind of a two-sided business. One was truly revenue generating, dedicated group of providers really around our first touch strategy. And the second was really around supporting providers who wanted to deploy telemedicine somewhere in their practice, whether it was, you know, just trying one video visit a day or a week or whatever it might be. And I think that what we always emphasized was patient experience. We always wanted the patient experience to be just as good as, if not better, than what people typically expected out of healthcare. And when we look at net promoter scores as, you know, a really good consumer benchmark, I think that the average net promoter score in healthcare is somewhere between 20 and 40, depending on the organization, which was really challenging for me to think about. What our CEO, Bill Robertson, had always said was, my expectation when we put together a true retail health first touch strategy that's really meant to be all wrapped around the consumer and their preferences and what they want. What do they complain about? They complain about access. They're not happy about parking. They don't know what their wait time is going to be. They want it to be easy for them. And I think that some folks conflated asynchronous care with a lack of patient centricity. And we found that just to simply not be true. For the 2 or 3 years in which we, pre-pandemic, when we ran with our virtual urgent care service, we were running at a net promoter score of 80 to 90 on a consistent basis. And so for us, that was based on really fast turnaround times, low cycle times for customers when they did go through their virtual visit. And so we tracked that obsessively. And I think for us, we're going to continue to leverage that type of net promoter score. And it's become essentially a standard at MultiCare from that perspective. But, you know, in the ways in which we think about delivering care today, and this is a bit of background, what CareConnect really means is that it's our technology partnerships business. So we're in the business of extending our enterprise electronic health record, Epic, and all the other tools and bells and whistles and third-party apps that come with it. And so for us, this is a fledgling business. We've been in business for a year and a half. We previously had it as kind of a secondary capability or side gig, if you will, to our enterprise technology efforts. And so for us, we have to think like any other startup or business out there has to when it comes to really measuring some of the key performance indicators that are marks of success. Except this time, I'm not really starting as a seed stage idea or a series A. It's more like a B or C where we're really trying to get the profitability. So every single one of my leaders has their own set of KPIs. They have their KPIs around turnaround times, around profitability, around SLAs to how quickly we close tickets, et cetera. And in the future, what we're going to be most interested in is, you know, when it comes to implementations of an electronic health record, for us, it's all about how much better can we get at this process? How much more incrementally can we be good stewards of our organization's assets? And what I love about this role is that I get to do that both as a leader of a team or an internal services company. And I also get to do that as a leader of our investment fund. And we basically get a different slate of KPIs for, you know, the half dozen or so companies that we work with and have invested in thus far.
And Ben, you brought up something really interesting. When you talked about measuring NPS of these consumer experiences, I was wondering, are you measuring NPS separately for different patient consumer interactions? As in, are you measuring NPS specifically for, let's say, the virtual care experience and a different NPS for, other parts of the consumer journey? And then my follow-up question is, are you also measuring NPS for specific care delivery experiences on top of like traditional HCAHPS scores collections?
Yeah, that's a great question, Josh. Typically, we measure net promoter score wrapped around a specific encounter per visit. That encounter can be virtual, it can be synchronous or in person, whatever it might be. I'm not sure if we've ever actually done that though for a specific longitudinal care journey, let's say an OB journey or, you know, a total knee replacement, because of, to be perfectly frank, there's still a problematic fragmentation of care. I would say that there's probably an opportunity to string that together as long as everyone's tracking against the same metric and kind of create a composite out of that. But that's only as good as your methodology.
Fair enough. So Ben, the reason we know you is, you know, MultiCare has partnered with Seamless MD over the past couple of years to do a system-wide rollout of digital care journeys to engage and monitor patients undergoing different journeys. So that could be, you know, hip and knee surgery, spine, bariatrics, maternity care. Those are things that we've launched so far with MultiCare. Could you take us back, you know, a couple of years ago to share with folks what motivated MultiCare to go down this path of implementing digital care journeys and how that fit into the overall digital transformation strategy?
Absolutely. So in my previous role as Director of Technology Advisory Services, my job was to translate the business requirements across a number of different business units and specialty service lines and hospitals and other facilities and you know, new models of care, and figure out what is the way in which we're going to get the most bang for our buck from a technology perspective. And what we started to see is people were beginning to realize, well, I need to be able to do two things. I need to be able to engage with patients at every step in their high reliability care journey, right? A set of protocols or pathways or plans where we know exactly what's going to happen along each step of the way. And that ultimately is going to become the MultiCare standard, regardless of whether you're getting that care at a hospital in Puyallup or in Tacoma or in Spokane. And so for us, we saw that not just in orthopedics or in cardiology or in bariatrics, but across a number of different service lines. And the other thing that we realized is we actually don't need just, you know, micro transactions that help with, you know, high reliability care or with high efficiency of use of resources, whether it's with appointment reminders or a reminder not to, you know, eat or drink, you know, the night before your surgery, whatever it might be, but some content that was definitely a little more contextually aware from a clinical perspective. And I think that we had a hard time finding who was going to be able to do both of those things, right? You can hire someone, or you can hire a vendor or a couple of team members to manage a MyChart SMS gateway. And that'll do some of the lighter load stuff. You can go source clinical content from a number of different providers and pay a pretty penny in order to kind of feed that in into your after visit summary. But we really wanted something that was end-to-end and focused on the journey, the way that we wanted to focus on that entire customer journey. And honestly, the way that a lot of payers are shifting their mentality too. And so the other, I think, forcing function to this was our need to meet a lot of different requirements, whether it was with a payer that said, well, if you want to be in business with us for this specific bundle, here are some of the things that we're going to say from a functional perspective you need. Or even from a state level clinical quality collaborative, they might have needed a shared decision-making module or something else. And it was through the help of these various vendors who agreed to come together and realized, okay, I don't get my point solution for my specific specialty or even for this specific you know, a care journey or bundle that I want to wrap an entire service around. We're going to really solve for elasticity of the solution, go for one set of integrations, and essentially combine both the clinically contextually aware content with those kind of single transactional capabilities. And that kind of whole hog drove us to really working with Seamless MD. And I think what made things easiest was not just an interest in peddling what folks already had. We're saying this is where integration works, take it, or even from a terms perspective, it was really around growing together and figuring out how do we make that shift from, and I'm going to use the catchphrase, volume to value, with, you know, longitudinal episodes of care plans, so to speak, across, you know, wrapped around a procedure, and have that platform grow with us as our payment models continue to modernize over time.
So I had to give a kudos to yourself, Ben, and the team at MultiCare. You've been really, really nimble partners, I would say, in how quickly you've not just implemented, but supported the partnership. So shout out to you and the team. Can't say anything but the great words about how collaborative you are. And I think for some other you know, innovators or companies out there looking for a great partner to you know, innovate and grow quickly. MultiCare has been a fantastic one. So shout out to you for that. And actually, maybe Alan's okay. I'm going to jump around a little bit in terms of our agenda. I think that the MultiCare Capital Partners story is unique. I think, you know, we've been seeing in the environment the last couple of years that health systems having these innovation and strategic investment arms is, I wouldn't say it's that common, but amongst some of the leading health systems, it's starting to become something that they do. And many, you know, outside of MultiCare and a few others haven't really embarked on this strategy just yet. So do you mind sharing with the audience, first, like, how do you view your role with MultiCare Capital Partners? And why are leading systems like MultiCare going down this path of having these strategic investment arms?
So I think that a lot of this boils down actually to organizational philosophy. I'm on some calls with other health system VCs, and sometimes the story or the talk track that I hear is actually a concern of new entrants, threats, competitors, right? And to the extent that partnering is of interest to these new entrants, right, to the market, the folks who really want to transform care, we try to figure out, is there a complementary opportunity here? Or is this something that is truly redundant to an initiative we're already going down or something we're trying to work on for ourselves? And even if not, what can we learn from them? I think that that's a much more progressive mindset, and part of the reason why I've been at MultiCare as long as I have and will be here for as long as, you know, our leadership team is here. And I would say that for us, we would rather be your friends and colleagues than lose lunch money to competitors entirely, right? And I think that there is certainly kind of two different ways in which we view ourselves. One is around challenging our own operators and leadership teams to think differently as a forcing function. So if that means that this demo that I put you in front of changes your strategic plan or forces you to consider something differently that you had never thought about, awesome. If it means that you actually want to go one step further and partner with these groups because they make you better, all the more fruitful for us, right? And so that understanding, the education, the learning, not just for myself or for the MCP team, but for everybody, I think is a really strong platform. But then the second is really around advising and really hardwiring incentive alignment, right? We want to grow with these companies. We think that there are some that are certainly worth investing in. And this organizational philosophy ties back down to our mission, which is partnering for healing and a healthy future. The healing part, I think we're all familiar with. The healthy future part points to where healthcare is going. And our partnerships don't just stop at, you know, the local affiliates or other healthcare organizations in the industry. It also goes out to our constituents, to our customers and our colleagues, the consumers that go through our care journeys every single day. And that's also true for some of the new entrants and the innovators who we really could stand to learn from. And so in some of those instances, we've brought some of those folks in and they've helped advise us on what our strategy should be. And what I love about MCP is that while, yes, we're there to line ourselves up with series, you know, seed stage to series B or C companies and help them grow, I like to think that at MultiCare, we've got the right balance of size and scale and capability, where we're not so big where we're lost and we don't know who the leaders are at each of the individual hospitals or operating units who are providing frontline clinical care. And yet we're not too small to where we can't afford to make investments or carve out a budget or the flexibility to invest in co-developing a capability with someone else. And that keeps things fun for us and for the organization too, to be kind of observing the frontiers of healthcare transformation.
Yeah, I can totally see that. I think it's neat, just, you know, your views on collaboration and how co-developing these programs together really benefits everyone in the ecosystem. I think just following this track, another question we had, MultiCare is a member of a number of healthcare networks like Avia and the Innovation Institute, the Scottsdale Institute, and so forth. And collaboration of this type to advance innovation seems much more common in healthcare than other industries. And I'm curious to understand, why do you think that is? And what do you view the role of these membership kind of ecosystems? How do they play a role in helping MultiCare accelerate its innovation efforts?
I think it speaks to the intricacy of what healthcare is and what it requires, right? There are some historical regulatory or other kind of circumstantial barriers, right? That have created a level of, you know, organization to organization information asymmetry. And so for us, having these forcing functions and forums to learn from one another and share ideas is huge. You know, I'll take the Innovation Institute, for example. It really makes me wonder just how many great ideas that frontline clinical staff members or members of a healthcare organization and care delivery team have that die on the vine or are kind of episodic and then, you know, never come back again. And I think that runs very counter to our philosophy and certainly the Innovation Institute's philosophy that anyone is capable of being an entrepreneur, not just someone who, you know, happened to go to a certain school or receive the right education or, you know, happens to be in a circumstance where they're exposed to this all the time. And so if there are ways in which we can inspire creativity among our team members, that helps us. And I think that when it comes to our strategy at MCP of sourcing, picking, and winning, identifying industry trends among other organizations, whether it's at Scottsdale or through Avia, et cetera, helps us a ton in terms of the fidelity of our selection process. You know, I think that some health systems are very much in danger of becoming an echo chamber, right? Or really following through with whatever one or two people in the organization say. And so for us, diversifying that opinion only gives us a higher level of confidence, not unlike running a trial or a study.
Evan, I'm curious your thoughts on, how do I say this? One of the neat, sort of strange, mentioning things about healthcare is that in many ways, your collaborators, depending on your region, couldn't actually be your competitors. So you're in these ecosystems of these health innovation networks and collaboratives, and you're often sharing best practices and you even sometimes sharing data and learnings and insights on innovation. But you know, the folks in the room, depending on who you're presenting to, actually might be your competitor next door as a health system. Yet at the same time though, we're all in this together to improve healthcare for you know, patients everywhere. And so in some ways, we want to help our neighbors get better because we all care about, you know, patient outcomes. So I'm just wondering, is there a point at which these ecosystems actually want to stay small in a way so that way folks can be transparent and share and learn together and get better and avoid getting so big that maybe people don't want to share what they're doing because everyone's in the room and it gets a little bit strange? I'm curious like what that dynamic is like in some of these, you know, closed door meetings almost.
Yeah. I can't speak to that as much as some of my colleagues can in terms of their presence and what gets talked about. More often than not, because of the breadth and the number of folks who are participating in these networks. So here's an example. The Innovation Institute has 6 member health systems and they largely don't have contiguous or overlapping geographies. That makes it really easy for us to be really, to really speak transparently to, hey, here's my number one problem and how are you solving it? What are you thinking about? What are you seeing in the industry? And I think that having a high level of trust with the mediators of those conversations, right, our kind of counterparts who work at these organizations, helps a lot to identify some of the facilitated introductions or one-on-ones to say, well, you know, don't I have the person for you to chat with? They've done some really, they've really matured their thinking in this space and we'd love for you, Ben, to speak with them. And I think that these forums are large enough to where you can learn a significant amount from really any health system that's up there presenting on the podium and part of an industry trend. The other piece that I found really fascinating is some of the de-identified benchmarking and feedback mechanisms that are out there. For instance, if I needed to know more about another startup that is trying to, you know, sell into our health system, and we're really not quite sure, just asking around some of these other health systems that are at the table and any of these forums is tremendously helpful. Or if it comes to benchmarking data of, well, this is how you're performing, or this is, you know, how much you spend relative to your peers who are adjusted for size and geography and breadth. Both of those things are, I think, really helpful contributions that still make it worthwhile to us outside of the peer-to-peer feedback mechanism.
Yeah, but that's totally fair. That makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. Maybe you brought this up earlier, and Alan had this great question here. So by the way, just for the audience listening, Alan's one who does all the hard work preparing for this. And sometimes I segue into some of his questions, but you brought up mentorship that you've had and how you've had some great mentors who just kind of threw you in the deep end, which I love, because I think in many ways, like, until you're forced to kind of tread on your own, it's like, it's hard to really learn. So I think that was like a great story you shared earlier. And it's also, you know, I think why you've shared in the past in some conversations, why you also yourself now spend the time to create space for your mentees to succeed and do well. Can you like dive a bit more into, you know, why you feel having mentors and then also later on being a mentor is so important for growth?
Mentorship is something that's very deeply personal to me. And it's because since undergrad and grad school, I've had different people who've taken me under their wing at different points in my life and have given me really two things. One is the kind of the X's and O's, the tactical stuff, right? Here's how I'd approach this conversation. What's an issue that you're dealing with today? How are you going to go about it? But I think more than anything, particularly in this world of social media and LinkedIn and everyone having a big fancy title, et cetera, I'm sure a lot of emerging leaders will resonate with this, but a lot of people probably feel a ton of anxiety and imposter syndrome. I know I did when I first started my career. I still feel it to this day in different forms, depending on where I'm at. And so I think that the core message that every single aspiring leader needs to hear is that you belong, right? And to have great mentors who will both challenge you to push you out of your comfort zone just a little bit and know what that line is, and at the same time reassure you. And I'll never forget some of the words that my preceptor in the fellowship, Christy, shared with me, which was, you know, and she said it to me as though, you know, she said it to me like my mom did when I was trying on a new pair of shoes. Don't worry, you'll grow into it. And so pushing that person, instilling the confidence in them has been huge. And over time, I've always thought of myself as having my own personal board of directors. And these are lifelong mentors that I've always wanted to stay in touch with. And if you haven't heard of this concept before, I'd highly encourage it, because I feel like you can find that slate of 4, 6, 8, however many people it is who can be your individual confidants and to show gratitude to them. And I think that this is intended to be part of a virtuous cycle, right? Sure, there might be things that I can do for my mentors from a work performance perspective, or maybe to help them find the next volunteer opportunity, whatever it might be. But I don't think that, to me, it's always felt not incongruent, but slightly imbalanced. But every time I've asked them, what can I do to help you? They say, well, pay it forward the same way that, you know, I helped you. And that's where I found a lot of meaning in making time for folks and making sure that, you know, they can spread their wings too. And I don't think that it's ever too early to do that. It's really interesting, because I think that some of the lessons that I learned from, whether it was my parents or some mentor that I had in graduate school, or I had a mentor in graduate school. His name was Jeff Sconyers. He was the general counsel at Seattle Children's for 20 years and was my professor in grad school, helping at my first job. And he always talked about being a mile wide and an inch deep from a skill set perspective. And I found myself using that exact same phrase 2 weeks later at a wheelchair basketball practice with a guy who was a great shooter, but wasn't a great defender or passer yet. And I said, hey, if you want to go play at the next level, you got to be a mile wide and an inch deep in everything that you do. And today he's making me very proud. He's now a senior at Auburn University. They're on a partial scholarship to play intercollegiate basketball, and is now an alternate on the United States Paralympic team. And wow. So I think that cross-pollinating the lessons that we learn from one environment to another, there's a lot of value in that.
Yeah, totally agree with that. Actually, and Ben, I wanted to ask you a little bit about this volunteer work that you're doing. You've been with the, I can't remember the organization's name, but the wheelchair basketball team for quite a while now. And I'm curious, how did that start? Like, what drew you into to get involved there?
Yeah, I think coming back to Seattle after a few years away, there was something missing beyond the regular school, job, self-care piece, and another way to be pushed, if that makes sense. That's really how I fell into it. I had never had any intention of coaching. I just wanted to show up and, you know, rebound for kids and, you know, teach them how to shoot, and that was about it. But then the volunteer executive director at the time said, well, we need a coach this year. And if it's not you, they're not going to get to play in this tournament this Saturday. So that's, I guess, one way to conscript someone into it. And just like work, I think I fell into it and kind of ran with it. And thankfully, I had kids who were both thoughtful and wise and humble and smart enough to know that their coach didn't know much about the tactics of wheelchair basketball, which is very different from, you know, stand-up able-bodied basketball. But all the same, there was still an opportunity for me to learn when it came to analyzing someone's skill set, motivating them to push harder, thinking about the events, whatever it might be. And I think that it became something where the first couple of years, what I was really focused on was giving back and some of the pillow soft thinking of, you know, oh, I'm doing so, you know, I'm trying to volunteer and do good in the world. And I think that where I began to let things go a little was when I was just as intense and competitive and about skill building and competition as the kids on the team were. And that's when I think I actually began to let go of any biases or to be able to see people for their disabilities and truly begin to see folks for, you know, just being another person who wanted to compete in a sport just as much as I did. And I think that's where I got a lot of joy out of it. Dating back to the origins of this, I've known a few people, and whether it's family or friends, who have disabilities and have always felt as though there's been an opportunity for folks to find the same level of competition. And so, and through some great experiences in college, I got to be exposed to that, to really see this happen, whether it was down in the Bay Area or across the country, and instantly got hooked. It was my two loves, basketball and volunteering, blended into one.
That's really cool.
So Ben, I have two follow-up questions. First one I'll ask is, you mentioned that there are some maybe unexpected tactics that you actually employ in wheelchair basketball. I was just curious, like, what is something that people wouldn't expect, but is actually maybe a big thing in the tactics there?
Sure. So something that I think is fascinating is what's called picking someone out. And this is where it's transition, you know, it's transition offense. You get a rebound, you kind of make your outlet pass, right? But on offense, what will happen is you'll usually have a faster player try to literally stop a defensive player who's trying to get back on defense from being able to even advance into their half of the court. So it's kind of like bullying, I'm not going to lie, but it's hilarious because sometimes you'll have, you know, a very, very kind of low to the ground, low class player who's like a 1 or 1.5. So it means that they have a higher level disability, maybe from the chest down, but because they're low to the ground and they're strong, they can push harder and faster than someone who sits up really high in their chair and is maybe a 4.0 or 4.5, you know, someone who's an amputee. And so it's really incredible to watch that person create a mismatch on defense, on offense. And the reason why that's tremendously valuable is now you have a 4-on-4 opportunity. You're spreading the floor out, right? So that way your team can operate with more space, and that creates better opportunities for offense. What's even better is watching 2 or 3 pickouts happen at once. And now you've got a 2-on-2 or 3-on-3 situation. One person releases, and now you've got a temporary 3-on-2 or 4-on-3 opportunity to capitalize on. You swing the ball enough, you find the open shot. And so that's something for us that we train a lot. And it's probably the reason why for a lot of our practices, we emphasize being the fastest and most physical team. And we started every practice and ended every practice with sprints. And that made, that turned, you know, these 14, 15 year old kids who were playing video games and eating junk food into honestly little Spartans. And that was really, really, that was a fun transformation to watch.
That's awesome. And then second follow-up question is more of a generic basketball question. So we're recording this on June 14th, 2022. I'm assuming you are a fan of the NBA and have some take on what's going on. The Warriors are up 3-2. Do you have a pick now for how this is going to, how the finals are going to end up? And then we'll have you right in a couple of weeks when this goes live.
So I might be wrong, and you're still welcome to keep this as part of the pod. But I think I'm going to call Warriors in 7. And, I wouldn't be surprised. I think Curry will still get the MVP, but I wouldn't be surprised if Andrew Wiggins got a couple of votes. He showed up last night on the defensive end. He was really cooking when it came to getting to the rim. I think Boston's a really hard environment to play in. And, you know, the fans are too proud to let this happen. So I expect to hear a lot of yelling over the mic or a lot of silent blips during the broadcast on Thursday.
Yeah, I think I picked Warriors in 6 at the beginning, but I think it could go 7. And I think Steph will be the MVP, but we'll see. We'll see. All right, maybe I'll back to healthcare.
Although,
maybe we can start a basketball podcast.
Yeah, exactly. We'll do a spin out.
Bill Simmons, hit us up.
Yeah. So I don't have necessarily a healthcare, digital healthcare related question for you, Ben, but I did want to ask about a topic you've talked about in the past, which is around model minorities. And I think you've talked in on a previous podcast on health equity about model minorities and why you believe taking pride in being a model minority actually could damage the opportunity for other minorities. And I believe diversity and inclusion within a system only can make that system better, and healthcare being a system that's built for the community is no exception. And so I was curious, how has your experience as an Asian American shaped your views on healthcare leadership? And what are some of the biggest challenges that you've had to overcome to get to where you are today?
So I think that there's a delicate balance because two truths can exist at the same time, right? Mm-hmm. But one truth is, I think, the farce or the myth of a minority. And I think that the best way it's been explained to me and the best way that I've ever thought about it is that being termed a model minority almost feels like a badge or a comparative, you know, less than or better than kind of measuring stick, in that there's only one archetype or one work style that actually contributes value in the business world. And that's simply not true. And the last thing I want to do is be used as a comparison to someone else who, you know, is not a, you know, cisgendered white male. Right, to then, you know, be compared to. That's not what the value really is. At the same time, I think that there is room in both the working world and in our personal lives to be proud of whatever our heritage is, right? This last month was AAPI month, and we wanted to make sure that we celebrated that. This month is Pride month. We want to make sure we celebrate that as well. And so I think that there is room to both be proud of what your heritage is and to be careful about what types of labels come with that. And I think that particularly, you know, my role as an Asian American leader in healthcare is actually meant around pushing boundaries for others too, and standing up for, you know, every cause that exists where, you know, specific ethnic or racial or other groups have been, you know, marginalized or oppressed in the past. And so for us, that means celebrating the various holidays and months of the year where things are really stick out for us. It means embracing people for the diversity and the unique thinking that they bring to us, and rewarding people who might be seen as contrarians, because at the end of the day, what they bring to us is all in the interest of making us better. And, you know, I have a lot of gratitude to give to, our MultiCare senior leadership team, because in past organizations I've worked at, the lack of diversity on some of the calls is pretty staggering. And so there weren't a lot of people in the room like me, whether it was from a race, ethnicity, or from an age perspective. And when I look at someone like Florence Chang, my boss, who's the president of MultiCare and was previously our chief operating officer, and previously before that, our CIO, she paved a huge path in that regard. But I think that embracing diversity and equity and inclusion is not necessarily about where the stats are today or saying we're good enough. It's actually rejecting that mentality and having a continuous growth mindset as an organization, as an individual, to say, you know, we can always be and get better, right? Most boardrooms and C-suites still are not nearly diverse enough, and that forces us to do a better job of representing, right, the constituents and the patients that we serve, of representing the workforce that we want to attract, and really looking at the data with the same level of rigor that you would when you're measuring your net promoter score, your turnaround time, or your budget for that instance. And so, you know, I think that the way we should be thinking about it is, I know what you as an organization, you as an individual are capable of when you really put your thinking cap on and apply your business acumen. So why wouldn't you do the same thing in this direction from a diversity and equity and inclusion lens? And so, you know, the last thing I'll say is, I think that, and this goes back to imposter syndrome, anxiety, age appropriateness, et cetera. You know, I still face that today. And I wrestle with, you know, okay, you know, people see you for who you are. And so what are you going to do about it? And that is another opportunity for me to just continue to, it'll add more tools to my toolbox or refine them. That's probably a better way of putting it.
you know, that brings, that actually reminds something else you brought up earlier, Ben, which I really liked. I mean, actually, you brought up a couple of things I really liked that, that I actually didn't dig into, but maybe I want to at some point. One was, I loved how you mentioned earlier, you had some mentors who, I think one of the phrases was, you know, don't worry if the shoes are too big, you're going to grow into them. And I think it reminds me of how, just having someone who says that they believe in you can be so powerful because of imposter syndrome sometimes, where you don't think you're good enough or capable, but sometimes just knowing someone actually believes in you is so powerful. And like, I've had times here where, you know, I did believe in someone, but I didn't actually say it out loud. I kind of assumed that like they knew that I believed that they could do it, even though maybe they hadn't done it before and it was new. But in my head, I believed they could do it. But then it wasn't until they told me that, you know, just me saying it made a big difference. And then maybe like really rewired my brain around, okay, like you have to sometimes vocalize the support you have for people just for them to know that someone believes in it. It's so powerful. So what you said reminded me of that. So I just wanted to share that. It is a really, really big thing. And you know, it's funny because like even I feel imposter syndrome still, right? Like with you know, this company and my role. And it's like, I think, I mean, now I'm more comfortable with it. Cause I think like talking to folks like yourself, I know it's such a common feeling. So for me, it's been like pretty normalized, but I think to your point, for a lot of people, it's not, you know, unless you get exposure to, unless you know that someone like Ben is like, yeah, I feel imposter syndrome too. It's hard to realize that everyone feels that way. So I appreciate you being vulnerable and sharing that. I think that's really helpful for the audience, especially folks listening who a lot of, I think our audience is you know, interested in exploring moving into healthcare leadership, but has that sort of anxiety or you know, mental block around, am I good enough? You know, can I do it? So thank you for being vulnerable and sharing that. It's so powerful.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Josh. You know, there's two observations that I made in the last month that have kind of helped me solidify that belief and give me a willingness to share it. The first was, you know, I was over at a colleague's house the other day just for a quick meal. It was a social hour, and he just said, hey, I've been with my family, why not? So shout out to Michael Hahn, my chief medical information officer at CareConnect, because this activity they did with this family, it was subtle, but it was really powerful. And he said, you know, before we eat, and he's got two teenage kids, he said, before we sit down and together for dinner and eat, we always share one thing that we're grateful for. And I think that attitude of that activity of gratitude is really powerful and underrated. And more often than not, the gratitude that I usually have boils down to the gratitude that I feel for individual team members and that belief in them. So I've always found that to be a really useful exercise. And we do it a lot at MultiCare too. And then the second was for the folks who are in a new leadership position or, you know, or have expanding, you know, responsibilities of leadership positions. I have a coach of mine, his name is Bruce Merrill, and he said a couple times to me, said, well, Ben, you know, if you want to be a really great leader, there are probably some times where you're going to have to accept that, you know, in order for you to figure that out, you're going to have to be sometimes a mediocre one. And I don't want to settle for that, so to speak. But he said, yeah, there'll be times where it's going to feel like that and you're going to be okay with it.
Yeah,
there's a reassurance in that regard.
That makes a lot of sense. I picked up like you're clearly a winner and you look to win always, but having failure really is the pathway forward from learning perspective. So that makes a lot of sense. I do want to bring things back to digital health just as we round out this podcast and right before we jump over to the Fast Five. Today, Ben, there is an explosion of patient-facing digital health innovations, all these different kinds of solutions, digital care journeys, like we mentioned. But besides digital care journeys, what most excites you today?
Yeah, it sounds really simple, but asynchronous care is totally where things are going to go. And it could be as simple as chat. I hope it's not. I think natural language processing absolutely has a role to play. And I think that this getting away from encounter by encounter level or visit by visit data into more of a longitudinal health record is going to make a lot more sense for us, because some of these interactions are going to be brief, and we're going to have the tools, and we have tools that are emerging that can differentiate between an encounter that is or an exchange that is administrative in nature or is just an appointment reminder to something that has, you know, true clinical value. So to me, using text as the way in which we're as our base data set and all of these different clinical notes is going to be huge. And I could see that percolating to some specialty care, home-based care. And I think that there are some companies that do this well. I mean, setting up a HIPAA compliant private chat is not hard. It's augmenting that experience for the patient and provider to really accelerate down to what is actually happening. That is going to be huge. And that's where, you know, really interesting companies like Bowie Health or 98.6. I mean, Solve is doing that for us today. Everyone has their own flavor of it. And I first got really inspired by this because, you know, Zipnosis was putting together asynchronous, you know, protocols, right, of branching logic. And so the next step to that is adding more flexibility if, you know, some human couldn't anticipate what was going to happen next in that branching logic pathway. So I think that that's one thing that's really fascinating. And, you know, Josh, I think that, you know, you and I have talked about that too, is something that Seamless MD certainly has the potential for when we think about patient reported outcomes and escalations. You know, I think that there's a really interesting opportunity that's going to emerge with a continued expansion and scalability of turning our phone into your home-based medical device and diagnostic tool. That's going to take a long time. You know, we're bound by the constraints of what the hardware and firmware is capable of, but it has huge disruptive potential, and I'm still really, really interested in it. You know, I think that healthcare affordability and attainability is something that still needs a lot of work. And so price transparency tools are continuing to emerge, already exist. I really admire Heather Fernandez at Solve, who's been really pushing hard on, you know, really making sure that every consumer journey and experience is well informed, knowing exactly what the hell you're going to get paid and being really crisp on that at the time of service. And, you know, for folks who are interested in what's going to be happening out in the future, I'm really actually interested in what's happening in China. I think China has done, there are some companies out in China that have done an incredible job of accelerating what digital healthcare transformation looks like. Companies like Ping An, Good Doctor, that have already created international, you know, subspecialty telemedicine networks, or the fact that they could stand up a hospital in, you know, what was it, 3 weeks or 4 weeks using, you know, modular design. That's transformative. And it should be pushing us to be better, because when you think about building a new hospital and a major capital facility plan, right, the master plan, you're talking about 12, 18, 24 months here in the United States. And then the last thing that I'll say is the silver tsunami is absolutely real. And so I think that there's going to be a proliferation of companies, or the growth of several companies in the space of elder care, particularly for Medis or other PACE programs, that's going to be absolutely tremendous, because we've got to find a way to take care of you know, this aging boomer generation.
I love that.
Amazing.
Awesome. So Ben, let's jump over to what we call the Fast Five lightning round, five questions to get to know you better for our audience. First question we have, what is your favorite book or book you've gifted the most?
You know, just in line with our conversation, Mindset by Carol Dweck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that book too. Question two, this is specific for you. What instrument did you play during your undergrad, and do you still play?
I was a trombone. I played in the Cal marching band as part of the little script Cal that you see on the football field, and was in jazz ensemble. I don't play today. That is my next endeavor when I can get 4 to 6 hours a week back. I really want to get back into it.
That's awesome. Question three, would you rather have super strength, super speed, or the ability to read people's minds?
I would love to be able to read people's minds.
So there's a follow-up question that we always ask. What if you can't turn it off?
Oh. I think I'd rather have super speed.
Yeah. It's always the way. It's good.
There's always something as knowing too much. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Question four, what is something in healthcare you believe that others might find insane?
So for folks who are outside of healthcare, I think that people will find fax machines insane. Mm-hmm. I think that for people who are inside of it, I think that you should look up what a certificate of need is. Because some people will look at the requirements for it and think, how is this what is driving strategic decisions in healthcare today?
Interesting.
Wild to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Last question that we have, Ben, this is a pandemic lockdown related question. What is one hobby or activity you've gotten into since the beginning of the pandemic?
I have an embarrassing answer and I have a straight answer. So my straight answer is that I started getting into golf.
Nice.
It's actually been a lot of fun. I totally understand what people say when it's a mental game and you're playing against yourself as opposed to a course or whatever it might be. So I found a lot of fun with that. Although Seattle's not a great place to pick it up because it's raining half the time. The embarrassing answer is I got into Fortnite because my friends and I from college needed to do something to bond and catch up together. Although I promise you that stopped.
Yeah,
you know, Ben, with the growth of esports, I think maybe in 10 years golf will be the embarrassing answer and Fortnite will be the cool answer, so you're just an early adopter.
You know, what people are going to say is the blended answer, and I don't know if it's going to fall on the side of cool or dorky, is virtual golf using you know, an Oculus Quest or something like that.
Right. Yeah, actually they've opened up. I know there's actual facilities like for, you know, a virtual driving range and you hit against that, but they've opened up, but I think it's Top Golf where it's like, you know, they're real competitive. Like everybody gets there, have a drink, play. It's really fun.
It's a great time. And no, Alan, I was not at a screen golf facility last week. Playing
fun. Were you? Yeah. That's great. Well, awesome. Ben, thanks for taking the time to come on the show with us today. You've shared a lot about MultiCare and the way that you're viewing digital health moving forward and some of the strategic initiatives that you're involved with, some of your thoughts on the future. I really love it. You can find Ben on Twitter at BerkChao, I believe it is, BERKCHAO. And that's a wrap for this episode of The Digital Patient hosted by SeamlessMD. You can follow us on Twitter at SeamlessMD. And if you like the podcast and you want to learn more, www.seamless.md. Thank you, Ben, so much.
Thanks for having me.